go to worship. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Our opening gathering song is Thy Word, number 8 in your praise songbook. Lenten journey.
It is on this journey that we will face our greed and selfishness.
It is on this journey that God will confront us.
Our hearts are ready to receive God.
Come then, and let us move forward toward the cross.
Let us faithfully and confidently follow Jesus.
Our opening hymn this morning is number 82 in your hymnal, O Lamb of God, Most Holy.
Just a note before I play this song, I will be making a call about there will be praise. Otherwise, it's very difficult to follow. Okay? Yeah. Okay, not right then and there, but I will do a call.
Thank you. This time we reflect on the week that has just gone by, perhaps remembering things that we did not do and felt that, oh, sorry, I did not get that done. So let us turn now to the Lord, our prayer of confession.
Patient Lord, we have cluttered the temples of our lives with so many unnecessary things that they have blocked out your healing words of hope and mercy. Clear away our fears and frustrations. Give us clean hearts and spirits. Help us to be confident in your mercy and transformational love. These things we offer in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.
I assure you, in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thank you very much. You're not
hymn number 420.
420.
God of grace and God of glory.
And for you, dear. 420.
Wednesday is when you do the markings that signify the cross, and then whoever is in charge of that day, the pastor, whomever, gives that statement, from dust we come and to ashes we return, which is to remind us that we are from the earth, we go to the earth, and then it's done. But then the following Sunday is the first Sunday of Lent. And it's 40 days of meditation, reflection, thinking about Jesus, his passion. The week before Easter is called Passion Week. So thinking about that, the suffering that he goes through for the cross. And then Palm Sunday and Easter Sunday and Lent is over. But that period of Lent is a time of reflection. Now, some people, Christians, during that time, will give up something so that they can mimic a suffering in a small way of what Jesus went through. So even if it's something like giving up chocolate, what does that really accomplish if we don't center our thoughts on Jesus, on Palm Sunday, on Easter? And so some Protestants then, no, pick something that is good, reading a certain book or having something good that you do, helping in a certain place, for instance, during Lent. And the 40 days, perhaps it's a reflection of that time when Jesus was challenged, when he first, right after being baptized. So that's Lent. And every Sunday in the bulletin, I'll have a Lenten meditation with scripture. So it's reading your Bible, it's thinking about Jesus. I think I gave a challenge last Sunday more to consider the personality, the humanness of Jesus during that, and become familiar with your Lord Jesus Christ. So there you are. There are the meditations for this Sunday, and look for the scriptures each week in those meditations. Okay. Almighty God, we do ask blessing upon these two young people learning about you, reading for their first time into the Bible. We thank you for the blessings that we all have that we don't always realize. For this we are grateful, Lord, and for your giving to us your love and your suffering. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Let us join in the prayer for illumination as we approach our scripture and message.
Grant us, O Lord, to be a living congregation in which your Spirit shall speak to us today through your word, making us ready to serve you in your church with the gifts given to us, not to please men or for worldly honor, but in gratitude and love.
Amen. Kathy Shepherdson will read the scripture for today.
Today's reading is from Luke 14, verses 1 through 11, and I have the New International Version. One Sabbath, when Jesus went to eat in the house of a prominent Pharisee, he was being carefully watched. There in front of him was a man suffering from abnormal swelling of his body. Jesus asked the Pharisees and experts in the law, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they remained silent. So taking hold of the man, he healed him and sent him on his way. Then he asked them, "If one of you has a child or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull it out?" And they had nothing to say. When he noticed how the guests picked the places of honor at the table, he told them this parable. When someone invites you to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, for a person more distinguished than you may have been invited. If so, the host who invited both of you will come and say to you, "Give this person your seat." Then, humiliated, you will have to take the least important place. But when you are invited, take the lowest place, so that when your host comes, he will say to you, "Friend, move up to a better place." Then you will be honored in the presence of all the other guests, for all those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. It's the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There are various translations. And the main thing, of course, is to notice that it's on the Sabbath, a holy day. In the New Revised International, NRSV, the one key word that was not in what you heard was, and of course, he was going to the house in this version,
to eat a meal on the Sabbath, and they were watching him closely. Just then, in front of him, there was a man who had dropsy, D-R-O-P-S-Y, which is another word for the illness of edema. Edema, it's the swelling of the tissues in the body. Every week, I look at different commentaries and different books. I have lots of books, two tall bookcases, and then three or four short bookcases, and so I go picking through about the particular book. In this case, it's Luke, and then in commentaries, they have all of the Bibles broken down. And then there will be individual books that are written on just the book particularly. So I have some of those series. And then I'll have general ones. Take lots of notes. And there are different translations. The Common English Bible merely states that this man, the man with dropsy, was there at the meal. The New Revised Standard, he was going to the house of the leader. And just then, in front of him, there was a man who had dropsy. The New King James Bible states, as he went into the house, behold, there was a certain man before him who had dropsy. And the writers of these commentaries, I have the Interpreter's Bible Dictionary, which is about six big books, and then the commentaries, I think there's 12 of these huge, big books. But the writers of those who are assigned the different chapters to write about, different books to write about, they often do their own translations. So even that could be different. And usually they refer to the Bible that's called, has LXX on it, and it's called the Septuagint, which is a translation from the Greek. And the commentary written by a man named David Gooding is close to the New King James Version, and it reads, "One of the rulers of the Pharisees invited Christ into his house, and there right in front of him," says Luke dramatically, "there was a man suffering from dropsy. Christ could not have failed to notice him, and all the translations say the Pharisees are watching Jesus closely." In other words, Gooding believes they were in the welcoming hall, not yet at the table, which one commentary said. And plainly, the Pharisees had set a trap for Jesus, making very sure that a person with a sickness would be intersecting, meeting Jesus to where they could be right there upon him. The Pharisees still have a rule, religious rule, that is saying no working on the Sabbath. No labor, no working on the Sabbath. And the question is, will Jesus do this illegal act in front of them? Will he heal the man right in front of these Pharisees? Well, what do you think? Yet they became afraid to challenge him openly. So when Jesus asked a question, they stayed silent. And Jesus heals the man and sends him away. And then in verse 5, then he asked them, "If one of you has a son or an ox that falls into a well on the Sabbath day, will you not immediately pull him out?" Now they use son in these translations. And then there's a footnote, you go down. Many, if not all, of the ancient scrolls say donkey. But there is a rule that says if it is a person like a son, and it looks like they will die, they have to look like they're going to die before you can go to help them. But anyway, they stayed silent. They did not answer that question. And then I remembered, and wonder if you do, there was a phrase last Sunday that Jesus used that came from Hosea, and it said, "I desire mercy, not sacrifice." Don't sacrifice your donkey or course, and absolutely not your son, of course. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. And so here Jesus has outfoxed him again, and it's something which he's very skilled at doing. God even made sure that the Pharisees were denied with the cross and the sign by the cross in more than one language, the King of the Jews. A word or two about the Sabbath. Are you keeping the Sabbath holy? Well, of course, those who are here are keeping it holy today by attending a worship service. And if you are home, are you watching a service on television? Therefore, you are contributing yourself to a worship, giving of yourself to honor God on the Sabbath day. Are you breaking bread, as we have talked during these meals and sermons for Lent? And again, this strong rule of no work, no labor on the Sabbath, that is still followed by the Orthodox Jews, those who follow the rules. Personally, I have had very limited exposure to the Jewish faith. There was one experience that I had while I was attending law school. There was a special exclusive conference, and students of the law have been invited. The law school where I was going, here was this bulletin about this special conference, and law students could go. And I wanted to hear the special guest, which was Supreme Court Justice Scalia. And I'm so glad, so grateful that I went to hear him and to meet him and to have that experience. We have different opinions with conservatives and with liberals and far right and far left, but he had a real sense of humor and he was an excellent speaker. But on that day, I also attended one of the small classes that they had at a conference. Many times you go to one of these conferences and they'll have little meetings here and here and here, and you pick your subject of what you want to go to. So I went into this one not really knowing what I was going to find out. But the speaker was explaining why there was no working, no labor on the Sabbath day. There's no cooking on the Sabbath, and this, even if they're not Orthodox, many of the Jewish families, the women do all of the cooking up ahead of time. There is no cooking, so they have their meal all ready to eat on the Sabbath. There is no using electricity, and it's why the rule requires walking to the synagogue instead of riding in the car to the synagogue. The idea seems to be recognizing the power and importance of God, not depending on, depending upon God, but diminishing reliance on human-made comforts. And again, also, that the Sabbath is a special gift from God, and it is to be honored by careful observance. Years later, after I'd gone there, I was now attending seminary to become a minister, and some of the professors had a Sabbath rule: no emails, no phone calls, no contact on Sundays. That was their way of observing the Sabbath. Now, I don't know if they also went to worship, but that was definitely their rule. And then in one of the commentaries, a word of advice: we are in trouble if we keep these rules, follow the rules of our faith, if we are doing it to help justify ourselves because we have done that. In other words, to feel more righteous than others. This includes a more common thought: well, I go to church more often than he or she does, or I do such and such, which makes me better. No, that is not the reason why we are to follow the way of Jesus. And then I'm reading a little portion that was in the Common English Bible that I thought was interesting. Luke's Jesus goes to dinner party with Pharisees, tax collectors, and eats meals with the poor. The meals are the images of the kingdom of God there at the meal. Dinner parties were an important part of maintaining one's place in society. People bathed, oiled their hair, put perfume on in the afternoon in preparation for the special event, special social event. Sometimes a slave would go around the town to tell people the dinner is ready, the time to go to the party. As the guests entered the house, a slave would wash their feet. In the dining room, guests would recline on cushioned benches. Now, that's the first time I had read that. They recline on cushioned benches arranged in a U shape. Arranged in a U shape and resting on one elbow. Slaves would place the food on low tables placed in front of the benches, and the diners would slowly eat and drink while having conversations with people around them. So I guess that elbow was to help make it all firm and comfortable. The best seats were in the middle of the U, and the farther one that was away from the center was for the less important, less significant, showing one's status. So then you heard verses 7 through 11 of the people going to this meal. Jesus watches with amusement as the arriving guests select their place at the table. He decides to give the guests a lesson in saving one's embarrassment, and if by using care and selection, being honored instead, a lesson in humility. In other words, if you picked a spot here, the host could come to you and say, sorry, you need to move away down here, and then the honored person would come and take that place. Or if you were careful, as he suggests, you take a lower place, and then the host can come to you and say, oh, sit higher up, closer to the you. A lesson in humility. And I wrote, just imagine the fun in the awkward struggle getting up from the low cushioned seats in order to move, and especially the humiliation if you were told to move further down, and the rising up and the sitting down and the bumping. So it might have been fascinating to watch that. And I wrote, oops. In Jesus' day, apparently there were multiple times of the shifting up and down of the guests when they would go to the meals, when someone more important would come and you would have to move. My question, we heard about the washing of the feet by the slaves, so obviously they're saying that in these bigger meals, there would be staff. Why wasn't there a staff assigned to kind of direct the people where they should be? Of course, many of our modern meals, there's a nameplate. You have no question, all you do is look. And I went to a business dinner with my daughter, and it was, I think it's called Oak Glen Golf Club up on the hill here in Corona. She's taking a position here in Corona. And there, when you go in and you sign in, so to speak, and they say, oh, table 6 or table 10. So that was how it was done. Did Jesus have another purpose besides the hint about dinner protocol? Well, yes, there was his one sentence in particular of wisdom and of warning, and that was towards the end of the scripture reading. For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. And then I wrote, unfortunately, some who need to hear those words may never hear them, and would reject the premise if they did, ending up with hearts of stone. And of course, I'm sorry, in this political year, we're going to see plenty of it this year. And I guess it's understandable because they are trying to exalt themselves so they will get your vote. But if they go overboard on it, think about that. Those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who are humble will be exalted. There was a section of reflections on these scriptures, and I have four that I have picked out. First, the story of the dinner is a metaphor for the kingdom of God, or perhaps for a community of early Christians. Can we apply these messages to today in the way that we live? The issues of importance and priority is the underlying story. That is, do we spend too much time trying to justify our own personal importance? Three, can there be both a sense of self-worth and yet humility? In that vein, does it depend on fully understanding the values that Jesus has put forth? And finally, based on worldly standards, and this is a good quote, there will always be those with a higher status than we have. And there will always be those whom the world sees as below our level. We must focus on where God sees us, where God sees us, and move on from there. Amen. Let us stand, those who are able, and have the proclamation. Proclamation of Faith, the Nicene Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
You may be seated.